area. Now I would like us to go to a different region, to a huge country, bigger than a population bigger than some of our regions, and to hear from Faisal from Pakistan.
Thank you. Morning, everybody. Higher education panel, and you know, this morning Sir Graham was talking about TNE and its impact. Tertiary education, higher education, a very interesting subject, what's happening in the world, and like the chair of the panel, she said, the world today is going through increasing level of uncertainty. We come from Asia and the emerging economies, and if you look at Middle East and Asia and Far East, we have a reputation of not being perfect. But where is the biggest aspect of uncertainty coming from? It's coming from you here in London. We get shocked when we hear the word Brexit. We only hear the word exit from the dictionary. We get shocked when we hear that there's something called trumping in treaty. We get shocked when we hear rhetoric coming out from Moscow and planes being shot over international airspaces. So when you talk about uncertainty, the biggest uncertainty is driven from the more mature, developed and symbolic economies and where we are sitting in. The emerging economies, the underdeveloped, the underprivileged, the economies which are struggling with the United Nations SDGs, we have a whole new challenge. And here we talk about higher education, let me give you a different context. Higher learning and higher education in the future is going to be like Uber. If you can Uber a cab, you will be able to Uber a qualification. You will be able to Uber a university. And I'll tell you why. When you Uber, it's about reliability. It is about access. It is about cost. And it is about security. And now when you look at the higher education, you want reliability. You want access, local access, international reliability. You want to save that money. And you want a sense of security in terms of job and opportunity. So let's take that paradigm shift from so-called 20th century, a saturated and a factory model, scientific concept of globalization. The world, ladies and gentlemen, is not about globalization. It's about millennialization. You're dealing with this new cohort of millennials, young people bound with a new set of values and culture. We are armed with technology. We learn in different styles and different ways. Yesterday, Professor Cooper, he talked about populism, and he said that the drawback of populism is it takes towards protectionism. But I will add that protectionism creates polarization. And as we talk about this deeper sense of polarization, you need to understand where the world is moving to. That the same report the Sir Graham is talking about, it says in 2020, 50% of the 18 to 22 years old, your undergrad university population, they will come from India, China, Indonesia, and United States. And the remaining 50% in 2020 will come from Pakistan, Bangladesh, Vietnam, Egypt, Nigeria, Brazil, and Mexico. So that's your 18 to 22 years of the youth cohort by 2020. And here we talk about working in isolation. The single common denominator for GDP growth in developed markets for higher learning, Canada, Australia, UK, Europe, and America, is educational tourism. When you invite a student for this beautiful London experience here in London, it's not just a London experience, it's educational tourism. Ladies and gentlemen, you need to shift. Previously, you taught students subjects. Now, you're talking about skills and incubation and entrepreneurship. Previously, you taught them subjects, application and research. But in the future, you need to teach them ideas and you need to teach them a concept called hope. Uncertainty is going to drive a whole sense of social disintegration. Students today, let's take an example of my country that I represent. 63% of the population is under 25 years of age. Total population, 200 million people. There's no electricity, so I think the nation is busy producing babies. 63% of the population is under 25 years of age. 18 to 22 years old university going population is almost 15%. The number of registered universities by the regulator 179 only, as compared to 2,500 in China and more than 1,200 institutes of higher learning in India. And then we talk about insufficient lobby and understanding of the regulators and these transnational markets. So I'm pretty clear that the future of higher learning and higher opportunity lies in my approach, and I think it is also mentioned the United Nations Global Framework of TT&T. The future belongs to talented youth across the world, irrespective of the border, culture, identity, religion, faith, race, creed. Talented youth has to be taught through technology. So teaching and technology together will promote the trade that you're looking for to create the world GDP and come out of poverty and social disillusionment. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Faisal. You've introduced some new terminology to us, millennialization, I think I got that. But also the concept of mobility as educational tourism, and there sometimes has been the issue of international education being a privilege for the already privileged. Do we have enough equity in student mobility? Can we achieve more equity through different means? The sorts of things that you've been talking about, the use of technology, for example. One of the other issues that has been raised, but also that students now look at or look to when they're applying for universities, is around employability. Their expectations.